In this lecture, we'll be examining a tragic episode, the Armenian massacres of 1915, that in the enormity of these events stands out even against the vast tragic backdrop of the war as a whole. We'll examine in this context how scapegoating of one particular group would tip into genocide as a phenomenon. The First World War formed the context for the launching of what is considered the first full-scale modern genocide, the 1915 Armenian massacres in Ottoman Turkey, one of the Central Powers allied with Germany and Austria-Hungary. It's estimated that between 500,000 and 1 million men, women, and children of the Armenian minority in the Ottoman Empire were killed or died from abuse in the government's resettlement campaign and massacres. The Christian Armenians were considered a suspect population and a liability on the home front by the leadership of the Ottoman Empire. At a time of worldwide suffering, generally in the context of war, international reactions to these murders when news emerged of these events were muted. This important example shows how the war itself, as a total war, seemingly normalized mass violence. And the targeting of civilians would be an ongoing reality of the very phenomenon of total war. Beyond this as well, the Armenian massacres would form a precedent for later genocides of the 20th century. We want first to examine the origins and background of this phenomenon as a whole. The intensity of total war, historians argue, helps make genocidal conditions possible. Genocide simply means the mass killing of an entire group of people because of their identity, of the killing of a group of people or a part of that people, according to the formal judicial definition of genocide. War, as it makes mass violence seemingly normal, in some sense lowers inhibitions against this sort of particular form of mass murder. In World War I, what's often considered the first modern genocide took place in Ottoman Turkey. Clearly there had been massacres before in the past, but this form of mass murder united to the technological energies of the war was something new. Between 500,000 and 1 million Armenians were annihilated. An earlier history had preceded these horrific events. The Armenians were a Christian community within the Ottoman Empire with a long and proud history in the region. Indeed, it's very much a brutal irony that in earlier ages, the Armenians had been considered very nearly a model group or an exemplary minority among the many different ethnic groups of the Ottoman Empire by their rulers. This, however, would change over time as nationalist ideas grew. The Armenians lived mostly in the eastern portions of the Ottoman Empire, in Anatolia and south of the Caucasus Mountains, essentially near the border with Russia and with Iran. What was very important in this context was that other Armenian communities along the border with Russia spilled across the border. So in some sense, this was a community that had on both sides of these imperial borders related ethnic groups, which gave them sort of a transnational identity. But the Armenian communities weren't only limited to these particular geographic locations in concentration. They were also, as a minority, spread throughout the empire as a whole. They were spread throughout the empire's cities and towns and the ports on the Mediterranean as what's commonly called a commercial diaspora, as a people who excelled at trading and in commercial ties. They very clearly had fulfilled a tremendously important economic and commercial role in the Ottoman Empire, a role that eventually would nonetheless lead to friction that would produce the scapegoating of this group. In the late 19th century, their status as a model minority had started to change. And in particular, outside forces played a role here. In the late 19th century, Europeans started to speak of an Armenian question. And the Armenian question was part of a larger Eastern question. That's to say, what will become of an apparently declining Ottoman Empire? The Armenian question, however, took on a specific significance. It was a way of asking, what of the Christian minorities of the Ottoman Empire? If they face discrimination, who might speak up for them? Well, on the one hand, this anxiety over an Armenian question was motivated by a real concern for a religious minority that was related to that of other European Christians. But it could also, on the other hand, function as a pretext or a premise legitimizing the involvement of European great powers in Ottoman affairs as, in their own self-image, protectors of vulnerable Christian communities, as those who were defending the rights that had been accorded to these minority groups and thus fulfilling an important and very legitimate international legal role. Now, obviously, such claims of humanitarian intervention would at times be grounded and at other times would be seen by the Ottomans instead as outside interference that would be resented. With the decline of the Ottoman Empire's traditional structures, a growing nationalism grew up in reaction. In particular, the dominant, the ruling classes of the Ottoman Empire came to identify with Turkish identity. What earlier had been a multinational, multi-ethnic empire was now to be reconfigured as being somehow, at the same time, Turkish in identity. And the result was that Armenians, as a group that were quite distinct ethnically, fell victim to both stereotyping, discrimination, as well as violence as this nationalism grew. Both on occasion the commercial prosperity that they had won while fulfilling an important economic role, as well as their status as religious outsiders or religious minority, and their status as a protected group in whose favor the great powers could threaten to intervene, made them very conspicuous as a minority. They fell victim to massacres in the 1890s, so already well before the First World War, with the estimated toll somewhere in the number of 200,000 casualties. These massacres of the 1890s were notorious. They led to even more furious demands by the European great powers that the status of the Armenians be respected, and in turn, increased resentment against this group as well. At the same time, a very important change was taking place in the internal politics of what was often seen as a moribund Ottoman Empire. A young group of determined activists had emerged with a determination to modernize, to reform, and reestablish the Ottoman Empire on an entirely new basis. This group of young reformers or modernizers, self-conscious modernizers, were called by the name the Young Turks. And indeed, this is a phrase or a term, an appellation that continues to our own times. We talk about someone who's ambitious or who's a go-getter as a Young Turk. And that indeed hails from the reputation for dynamism and for ambition that these Young Turks had evidenced at the start of the 20th century. The Young Turks were an elite leadership group that grew out of a secret society called the Committee for Union and Progress that had been founded in 1900. The Committee for Union and Progress, as its very name suggested, pursued plans to revitalize the empire, to reform it, to make it more efficient, and in other words, to give it a lease on life for later in the 20th century. The Young Turks infiltrated secretly at first important positions of power. They came to exercise important influence in the officer corps as well as in the bureaucracy. And they came to power within the empire as a whole in 1908. Important changes, however, were taking place in the ideology of the Young Turks. Initially, their ideology had focused on somewhat vague ideals that were called Ottomanism. This ideology suggested that it was necessary to cultivate and craft and celebrate an overarching Ottoman identity, which privileged loyalty to the state and to the Ottoman dynasty over the whatever ethnic differences of language or of background might also obtain. So in some sense, their hope was that the establishment of a strong state and centralized state traditions would produce, out of their very vitality, an identity called Ottomanism. The very vagueness of these ideals, which in many senses could be quite inclusive, because one didn't have to be Turkish to share in this identity of Ottomanism. It was not an ethnic identity, it was a loyalty to the state that was being accented here. The very vagueness of some of these ideals, however, made them unsatisfactory to some young Turks. And their ideology started to change in this regard, fatefully. Instead, ethnic nationalism came to be emphasized ever more. And the ethnic nationalism that was celebrated was that of a Turkish identity. The First World War would give a great boost to this development in a more ethnic nationalist and less inclusive direction, because now groups like the Armenians or other minorities of the Ottoman Empire did not have equal access to this celebrated overarching identity. When World War I broke out in 1914, Ottoman state officials, among them young Turks, feared that the Armenian Christian minority was in some sense an alien presence in their own midst. And in the scapegoating and the focus on this ethnic group itself, suspicions arose that the Armenian Christian minority might actually collaborate with the enemy. These suspicions were stirred by the fact that the Russians, just across the border, had Armenian minorities of their own who might engage in propaganda to lure Armenian minorities in the Ottoman Empire for the cause of achieving independence under Russian patronage. And thus, it was ordered that measures should be taken against the Armenian minority. At the same time, some of the war aims of the Ottoman Empire, its goal, quite expansively and unrealistically, as it turns out, to seek to achieve a pan-Turkish empire, even larger than the present extent of the Ottoman Empire, stretching into Central Asia and taking populations that currently were under the rule of the Russian Empire, once again accented an ethnic basis, an ethnic foundation for the identity of a future state. And this once again left the Armenians and other minorities isolated. The key figure in the measures that now were organized against the Armenian minority was Talat Pasha. Talat Pasha was the interior minister and a young Turk leader who directed the police forces of the Ottoman Empire, and who was instrumental and later quite candid about aspects of the planning and of the actions taken against the Armenians. In particular, these first plans dictated that threatened strategic areas were to be, we would today say, ethnically cleansed of minorities. These were areas that were particularly vulnerable, it was felt, to outside influence, and having populations that were considered, precisely because of their minority status, less loyal, perhaps, less reliable. These were areas that needed to be, in essence, remade ethnically through expulsions. And in particular, Greeks, as well as Armenians, who were seen as notoriously unreliable, both of them, precisely because they had ethnic relations across the borders, were singled out. The strategy that was pursued was that of deportation. And indeed, deportation had a longer history in this region. The Ottomans earlier, as well as other Middle Eastern empires, had practiced the picking up and the removal of entire ethnic groups from one region and settling them down into another region as a strategy for how to deal with ethnic difference and ethnic minorities in past centuries. But this was taking place in a modern context, in the context of modern total war. And so these policies of deportation would turn into something different as planning and actions continued. At the same time, special security units were organized and established to enact these plans. These special security units were called the secret organization, the Teskilat-i-Masusa. They were established to enact the plans that had been organized in advance. And now the massacres began. The killings opened with a preparatory stage that made clear that they were not entirely spontaneous, but indeed that preparations had been taken, which now unfolded. Armenian soldiers who had served in the army of the Ottoman Empire had been previously and slowly, cautiously, reconfigured into units in which they were no longer in mixed ethnic military forces, but instead Armenian units themselves. And these then were disarmed, and the men in those units were killed. Then another wave of killing took place, and it started on April 25th, 1915. This first wave of arrests followed by killings coincided, and it's probably not a coincidence, with the Allied Gallipoli landing, which aimed to force the defeat of Ottoman Turkey in the war, the opening of the Dardanelles, and a strategic breakthrough that would yield final victory in the First World War. This Allied Gallipoli landings had taken place in April of 1915, and in some sense were creating at this very moment an urgent sense of crisis and of emergency, which the Young Turk leadership saw itself as responding to. The plans were also spurred on or accelerated by some armed resistance by Armenian communities and communal violence. In one case, when there actually was resistance towards the Turkish forces as they moved in to an Armenian community, this was quelled with difficulty, but with immense violence. And this was pointed to afterwards in a sort of catch-22 as proof, allegedly, of the fact that Armenian communities had been planning a revolt or an uprising, even though, in fact, they'd been reacting to outside aggression. Indeed, at the same time, Russia had been, as an outside power, encouraging some of the Armenian rebels as part of the sort of program that all of the fighting powers were pursuing towards minorities in their enemies' populations, that policy of revolutionizing one's enemies' discontented groups that we've discussed in an earlier lecture. What was especially telling, however, was that the massacres that now followed were focused not only on communities in which resistance had taken place or which were suspected of disloyalty in particular. Rather, the massacres focused on the Armenian community as a whole. In particular, the first stages of this process saw an attempt to, we might say, decapitate the Armenian leadership of this ethnic community. Armenian intellectuals and community leaders who had a long established presence in the imperial capital of Constantinople, today Istanbul itself, were among the first targets. They were arrested, and also at the same time, such natural leadership groups in the provinces were arrested as well, and several hundred were immediately taken out and shot. After the arrests of the leadership, which might have coordinated an energetic response and which might have pleaded internationally for intervention, now events continued to unfold. Deportations began of larger Armenian communities, often announced on extremely short notice. People were simply told by proclamation that measures were being taken to ensure the safety of the Armenians, who it was claimed had shown their disloyalty but would be protected from the righteous wrath of the population at large by being moved away from the areas in which they had earlier lived. The men of these communities were often killed immediately, insofar as they hadn't actually been drafted before, moved into Armenian units, disarmed, and killed in the opening stages of this campaign. Women, children, and the old were now rounded up and were told to prepare for marches. These marches amounted to death marches, and there are stories or witness accounts of women begging to be shot on the spot rather than being launched on this long, agonizing trek towards death. Over the next 2 years, it's estimated that 2 to 3 million Armenians were deported from eastern Anatolia and other parts of the Ottoman Empire and marched, they were told, towards Syria, towards the Syrian desert. It was on occasion explained that they were simply being resettled there and that camps and settlements awaited them. No such preparations, in fact, existed. By some estimates, a third of the Armenians were massacred, a third perished en route in these marches, and a third survived. It's estimated that 500,000 to 1 million died, killed outright or from exposure in the desert. And these numbers are tremendously difficult to reconstruct accurately, and debate still rages about which numbers are most accurate. The numbers I've mentioned represent lower estimates. Some estimates run as high as 1.5 million dead. These campaigns, these marches, and the massacres were marked by immense brutality. Men were bludgeoned to death in front of their families. On occasion, children were thrown into rivers. Young women were taken away, raped, or forced to convert to save themselves, or included as slaves or as wives in the households of those doing the killing. The Young Turk leadership encouraged these measures, but many historians believe today that no one single order was issued for the killings. Rather, measures had been planned in advance and took on a dynamic as well of their own. We might ask how this phenomenon of ethnic cleansing tipping over into genocide in the context of war, how this would play internationally, what sort of reactions it might elicit. And what's involved here, what's at stake, is obviously a key insight into how, in the context of total war, civilians themselves become targets. And war and conflict and battle can become cover for things taking place behind the front lines, cover for genocide. This is precisely what would later happen in the Second World War, when the Nazis would, under cover of the war itself, at the same time fulfill their plans, the genocide of the Jews of Europe as well, seeking to hide it during the reality of war. Let's speak then to the international reactions that followed. There were attempts made by those enacting the massacres to hide the program as it unfolded. So, for example, even though the leadership elites of the Armenian community in Constantinople, in the capital, had been arrested and executed, the entire Armenian community of Constantinople was not removed and instead seemed to be spared as an example of the massacres that were not taking place. Nonetheless, in spite of these efforts, news did trickle out to the outside world. And it really is, unfortunately, a tragic but eloquent statement of the enormity of these events as they were taking place, that the first reports that filtered out were simply too brutal and too monstrous and barbaric to be believed at first. But soon, such testimony was pouring out in a volume that could not be denied. In May of 1915, the Allies, that's to say France and Great Britain, warned Turkey against these crimes against humanity. It's a new concept coming to the fore at precisely this time. And also, in a really revolutionary sense, promised to hold the leaders responsible for these crimes against humanity to account after the war. An especially tragic case was that of the anguished American ambassador, Henry Morgenthau Sr., who was horrified to start receiving reports from his consuls of what was happening out there among the Armenian communities. He didn't hesitate to pass along news of these events through the diplomatic channels to America's political leadership. But American neutrality at this stage in 1915 and in the following year, American neutrality in the war at this date complicated the chances for any stronger American response. Nonetheless, while the government sought to avoid the sort of statements and strong condemnations that might have, as they worried, impinged upon their stance of neutrality, news was flowing out of these events. And American newspapers carried news of these tragedies in some detail throughout the events themselves and the aftermath. In Germany, a very special case obtained. Germany was the ally of Ottoman Turkey. And nonetheless, Turkish actions against the Armenians did not meet with strong reproof, precisely because Germany saw itself as needing the full energies of its ally in this conflict. Nonetheless, on the part of some Germans, voices of conscience could be heard, urging their own government to demand a stop to the atrocities. The German ambassador to Turkey, Count Wolf Metternich, for instance, pleaded that something needed to be done. Horrified German missionaries who had been working in the hinterland of the Ottoman Empire also didn't spare in their reports a full picture of what was going on. And nonetheless, in these cases, these voices of conscience were brushed aside. The German political leadership simply explained that it was necessary to fight one's way through to full victory in the war with one's Turkish ally, regardless of what was going on. In some sense, the very scale of world events in this time of war, with millions dying on the battlefield with such rapidity, probably served to obscure a clear picture, a clear understanding of what was happening to the civilian population in the Ottoman Empire. It's probably also true that the fact that the victims were not Europeans, or that their life, their way of life, was not fully and clearly known by many people at the time, this probably also, unfortunately, reduced a sense of concern and urgency about the tragedies as they unfolded. We need to speak then to some of the outcomes and the precedents of this example of genocide, because the very lack of a strong international reaction, in some sense, established a precedent. This first modern genocide seemed to establish a terrible record that would be followed by later instances. And indeed, one could observe that a truly remarkable amnesia seemed to set in as the horrors of the events themselves, which had been reported, they were not unknown, which had been reported at the time of the war itself, increasingly were forgotten. Nonetheless, at first, there were attempts, as had been threatened, to hold those in leadership positions who had allowed this to happen or had planned it to take place. Immediately after the war, the British in particular insisted that Turkey put the perpetrators on trial. And some trials did take place, but the results were mixed because some key leaders, in fact, fled abroad and escaped justice, at least for a time. Among the leaders who had fled was the interior minister who had controlled the police and had been instrumental in these actions, Talat Pasha. Talat Pasha had fled, defeated Ottoman Turkey, and instead had resettled in Germany. In defeated Germany, he was not turned over to the Allies, but instead was allowed to continue living now as a civilian. In 1921, however, he was hunted down and killed by a young Armenian. A young Armenian whose own family had fallen victim to the massacres. A young Armenian whose actions had in part been planned by an Armenian exile conspiracy called Operation Nemesis that had been organized from Boston in the United States, whose aim was to hunt down and to take a vengeance upon those who had enacted the Armenian massacres. And the reference here, the classical reference to Nemesis, was to the inevitable revenge of the fates, which had figured in Greek legend as inevitably chasing down the guilty. This murder, which took place in Berlin, became a celebrated legal case. The young man who had assassinated Talat Pasha was declared not guilty, essentially by reason of mental faculties not being fully in play. We would today call this the plea of not guilty by reason of insanity. And though this case had been celebrated and had attracted international attention, in following years, attention faded, and And the memory of these events also likewise increasingly was not present to collective consciousness. Nonetheless, this new phenomenon was striking enough that a new name was given for it. The Armenians had been targeted not because of who they, what they had done, because of their actions in particular, but because of who they were as a group. To find a name for this crime under international law, a lawyer of Polish Jewish origins, Raphael Lemkin, coined a new word, and the term was genocide. Taken from classical languages, this implied the killing of an entire group of people or a portion thereof because of who they were, their identity. Now, the Armenian massacres were not the same as the later industrialized murder of the Jews, the Holocaust, the Nazis' genocide against this group on such a more efficient scale. But later, most certainly, from our present-day perspective, seemed to be a step on the way to the larger mass murders and genocides that unfortunately mark the 20th century. And indeed, one doesn't need to speculate about precedent. We have, in fact, testimony in this regard. Justifying his destructive plans on the eve of the Second World War, Hitler is supposed to have said, in a rhetorical question, as he talked about his own plans for the future, "Who today remembers the Armenians?" And the argument was clear. The amnesia that had befallen this genocide paved the way for later genocides. It's tragic as well that to this day the Turkish government denies this tragedy in its full scale and also denies full access to the archives that might give us a clearer picture of the tragedy itself, that it unfolded in the strains of war. We'll be considering next how the strains of war could produce as well social and national revolts, examined in our next lecture.